Good evening. Good evening. Good to see everyone tonight. What a great showing. Great to be together. Tonight is a night of thanks and thanksgiving. Tonight is our harvest dinner, and we're very excited to have you all here. God tells us in James chapter 1, verse 17, that every good gift and every perfect gift comes from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there's no variation or shadow due to change. Tonight we're here to give thanks, to acknowledge all the many ways God gives good gifts to us, to acknowledge the good God that loves us and has shown that to us in innumerable ways. He deserves our thanksgiving. So tonight we're going to hear from our church family. We've got testimonies that are going to be shared. Tonight we're going to hear some special music as well, and we're looking forward to having that, all from our church family. And tonight we're going to eat a lot of food, also all from our church family. We had a great time putting things together. I know everybody chipped in. We've got tons of food on the table, and we are very glad to enjoy that together. Yeah, we're not there yet, Ron. You got to. Tonight is also a night to continue a tradition, a time-honored tradition of our harvest dinners, and that is Pastor Tom's cheesy jokes. That's right. So, tonight's a night to have fun, to give thanks, to laugh. And so I'd like to open this evening with a little joke as we get started. Then I'll give instructions for food, pray together, and then we'll get started. So I actually shared this joke last year, but I thought it was a pretty good one, and it's a good opening here. A wife said to her husband, I've got a bag full of used clothing that I'd like to donate. The husband replied, well, why not just throw it all in the trash? The wife said, but there's poor, starving people who could really use all these clothes. The husband said, honey, anyone who fits into our clothing is not starving. God has richly blessed us, and it shows, amen? So tonight, let's enjoy some food. Let's have a great time of fellowship around the tables, hearing from our church family, and thanking our God together. Now, before I let us go, I'm going to let these first three rows here get dismissed first, plus Karen's table, because Karen's going to share with us a little bit too. Then we'll dismiss a couple rows at a time. We're going to start on this side over here where the drink station is right there. And I've already forgot what we have, but we have excellent drinks over there. And then we're going to work our way down the table this way. And we've got lots of food. The meat is on the opposite end, though, so make sure you save some room on your plate as you go through. Let's pray together as we get started. Father God, you are the good giver of all of our gifts. Lord, we need to give you thanks. And at the same time, Lord, there's so much abundance, so much good that you have given to us, and that is demonstrated in what's going to be on the tables for us and in the people sitting around our tables. We are grateful for each one, each plate, each item of food, each person that we get to share this night with. So, Lord, please bless this evening, and Lord, would it fill us with an abundance of thanksgiving to our wonderful and good Heavenly Father. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Well, how is the food? It's good. Yeah, not enough. You can have seconds. There's plenty left over, so enjoy that. Couple more cheesy jokes before we get going here. You know, I love bacon, and sometimes I eat it twice a day, and it really helps take my mind off the terrible chest pains I keep having. Remember, you don't lose your memory. You just get better at letting go of the past. And that makes us thankful, and that's what we're here tonight. One of the things we want to do tonight is we want to share stories. We want to hear stories shared from our church family, stories of Thanksgiving. And I'm going to call Karen up in just a moment, but before I do, I was even just handed this morning a note from Natalia Zanal, because Natalia and Leandro are celebrating 18 years of marriage tomorrow. Yeah. And she wrote this and sent it to me, and so I'm going to read it here, and this is another story of thanks. Wasn't even planning on this, but we get to share this as well. She says, "My life should be an eternal declaration of gratitude to the Lord. God gave me hope in life when no one, not even myself, believed in me. And by his mercy, I'm not consumed. Your blessings reach me even when I run from them, and without realizing it, do everything to lose them. Lord, thank you for the countless blessings you give. Thank you for making Leandro and I celebrate 18 years of marriage this year. Ebenezer, for till now, the Lord has helped us. It's not 18 days, it's not 18 weeks or 18 months, but it's 18 years of God's grace and divine goodness. I know that God takes care of me and uses you for this. I know that we are only at the beginning because we are heading towards eternity together." Natalia Zanal. Yeah. Now, Karen, I asked to share tonight because when you think about a joyful person, Karen, I think, is right at the top of the list of people that come to mind. And she's always has a story to share, always a poem to share, always a passage of scripture to share. And many of us receive those every week. Karen also, just by God's providence, she was born on Thanksgiving Day. How about that? So I've asked Karen to come and just share a testimony of thanks with us tonight. Karen, please come on up.
I'd like to pray first, so let's pray. Lord, we pray that you would be honored and glorified, and I pray that you would bless each one here. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. I'm thankful for how God has moved in my life and brought me closer to him. He's the most amazing God you could ever even imagine. We learn about him in his word, but he's more than we can express. His word is... it tells us about who he is. And as we trust him, we grow closer to him all the time. He's so cool. Okay, I'm off track. Sorry. Psalm 95:2 says, "Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to him with songs of praise." I want to share a sketch of my life and why I am so thankful to God for his mercy and his grace. My parents divorced when I was about 2 years old. I was living in and out of children's homes, part of the time living with my mom. One day, when I was about 9 years old, I was walking by myself in downtown LA. I remember looking at the red light, waiting for it to turn green so I could cross the street. I stepped off the curb, and that is the last thing I remember before waking up in a hospital. Someone told me that I had been hit by a truck and had been unconscious for 2 days. My left leg and left arm were broken, and they were in a cast. When I was released from the hospital, a Baptist family took me to live with them. They told me Jesus loved me. I was thinking, where is he? They read the verses in the Bible that told me Jesus loved me. He died on the cross to pay the punishment for my sins. The Bible said that God would forgive me and I could be born again of his spirit. He would love me forever and teach me to follow him. I ask God to forgive me and be my Savior and my Lord. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. The next Sunday, someone pushed my wheelchair forward to go to the front of the church. The pastor explained everything again to me. A person does not have to go forward, but I really wanted to. I needed to know for sure I was saved and belonged to Jesus. I have never been alone or the same since. I now understand why the accident happened. I should have died, but instead have eternal life. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. I still have a scar on my left ankle from the accident that helps me to remember to praise and thank the Lord. Psalm 104:33 says, I will sing unto the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praises to my God while I have my being. Let me tell you one more reason why I'm thankful to the Lord. After college, I married Bill May, whom I thought was a Christian. The marriage ended in divorce, and God gave me one of my life verses to direct me to trust in him. Isaiah 41:10. Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. We had two sons. Brian May went in the Navy and served for 30 years in the medical department. David May went to Master's College, Westminster Seminary, and now serves in Tulare County with Good News Jail and Prison Ministry. We thank God for taking care of us all these years. One day we will see our Jesus who saved us by his grace. One day we will see our Jesus and look into his face. I'm almost done. In 1998, God blessed me to meet and marry Ben Fleming, an amazing Christian man who loves and follows the Lord. Our amazing God did this. I would like to close by reading Psalm 23, and anyone who loves the Lord is invited to read it with me. Did they put it on the screen? Okay. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Thank you very much, Karen. Thank you. Now, we have testimonies tonight. We also have special music. And before we do that, though, let me impersonate Pastor Tom for a moment. A man picked up a hitchhiker on a long highway. After a few miles, the hitchhiker laughed and said, "I am so thankful. I'm so thankful that you cared enough to pick up a hitchhiker. So many people are bent out of shape and afraid that they might pick up a serial killer or something." The driver replied, "Oh, I never worry about that. The odds of two serial killers being in the same car is very slim." Now, Florence has been faithful to lead us in worship every Sunday. She's been a staple of our harvest dinners in the past. She's also serving as a deaconess. And so I've asked Florence Wilson if she would come and lead us in a song as well. Thank you, Florence.
I don't have enough words. I'll never live enough lifetimes to fully know your worth, to know all that you deserve. All of my deceptions, all of my duplicity, now there is no record. You assume the best of me. And this is why I thank the Lord for saving me when I was weak. So I will sing. This is why I thank the Lord for everything. This is why I thank the Lord. All of my affection, everything I have to give, the sum of my attention is measured in the praise I lift. And this is why I thank the Lord for saving me when I was weak, so I can sing. This is how I thank the Lord for everything. This is how I thank the Lord. Yeah, this is how I thank the Lord for loving me and keeping me, so I will sing. This is how I thank for everything. This is how I thank the Lord. I will sing, I will sing, I will lift my praises to you. I will sing, I will sing, I will lift my praises to you. I will sing, I will sing, I will lift my praises to you. I will sing, I will sing, 'cause this is how I praise the Lord. And this is how I thank the Lord for saving me when I was weak, so I can sing. This is how I thank the Lord. 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 Thank you. And this is how I thank the Lord.
Thank you, Florence. That's special. This year marked 40 years that Tim Traeger has served on our worship team here at our church, First Baptist Church. This year also marks my 40th birthday. Actually, it was last year, so I'm 40 years old too. So before Tim comes up to share with us, just a few jokes on getting older. When I was young, I was poor, but after years of hard work and honest, painstaking labor, I'm no longer young. If I dropped something when I was younger, I just bent over and picked it up. Now, I'm older, and when I drop something, I stare at it for a while, wondering if I really need it after all. And most people don't think I'm as old as I am until they hear me stand up. So, Tim, why don't you stand up and lead us in a song? Yeah, thank you. Tim's doing double duty, too. He's going to sing a song for us and also share a little bit of a testimony as well. Thank you, Tim.
We have some short people here. with my eyesight, I need to see it closer. I'm going to start off with a verse, Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans for you, declares the Lord, plans for welfare and not for evil, to give you a future and a hope. My title that I wanted to do is The Wise. My Wise. You know, we all have the wise. Why did this happen? Why? Why did I have to go through that? Why is this? And some of the whys that I have was heart problems when I was born, moving from San Anselmo, which we lived when I went to grade school, and Dad left right before junior high. That's a why. Moving my senior year from Selma, because we moved to Selma, moving my senior year to Selma, from Selma up to Spokane, Washington, where the graduating class was bigger than our school in Selma. Quitting my job at Napa Warehouse. It was the greatest job I ever had. It was so fun. And I quit that. Then moving to Fresno and going to Fresno Pacific College. And I moved my wife and our baby down here to go to college. Why would I do that? Well, my dad's a pastor, and we were going to work together in a church. I was going to be a youth pastor. And then while in Longview, our daughter was born with defects, and she died 2 days after she was born. So why did that have to happen? And then I quit the youth pastor. I decided, nope, it's not for me. And then while I was going to Fresno Pacific, I had a job at Me and Ed's Pizza. And I says, well, he offered me a job as a manager. I said, why would I do that? You know, now we have 3 kids and we're moving back to Fresno. And so that was a why. And then one why that I have no idea why it happened was my brother, at the age of 36, passed away of heart problems. And I'm not going to know the why that until I get to heaven, and that's for sure. Psalms 8:20 says, and we know that for all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose, Romans 8:28. When we moved to Dinuba in 1984, that was after I quit being a youth pastor, I said, okay, what's going to happen? We found the First Baptist Church in 1984, and right away we got involved with the church. Claudia taught Sunday school, and she's been in the nursery forever, and I was a secretary, not a secretary, but, you know, worked with the Sunday school. I taught with Dave. Dave, we taught us, where are you, Dave? Raise your hand. I don't know where you're at. Dave Jones? Oh, we taught us an adult class. Remember that? And I thought I had a bad memory. We did that over at the looked like a house. That was Pastor Tom's office, I believe. He does remember now. So we got through that. Then one morning, Nancy Stovall, who was more or less the choir director, or not the choir director, but she led the worship, she asked me, Tim, would you lead singing with me? And I said, what? You have 2 people up there going like this? I don't know. I guess. So we did, and she was getting a worship team together. And we got Dave Gaston, Mary Carter, Anita Gaston, myself, and then Steve Mark. That was our worship team way back there. So as I look back at the whys, all of those whys led to coming here. And one of the greatest things that we have felt here, my wife and I, is the love of the family here. We had Dorothy Dobbs. Remember Dorothy Dobbs? She was our secretary, and she asked me one time, Tim, could you make me a cassette of your songs? I said, sure. Al Farley, if you remember Al Farley, he was directing, he was in the sound booth, and he recorded for me, and I gave it to Dorothy, and that was the first one. And then I had other people ask me for songs, which, okay. For me, it was a lot easier to do CDs, because if I goofed up, I can go back and redo it until it got somewhat good. So I have done about 6-7 CDs now. The last four was professionally done in Fresno. Name was Raphael Carmony. He did that for me. And my mom and dad kept on pushing for more. So, and a lot of you have one of my CDs, I think. So I'm so grateful that you like the songs. They're all the older songs. Let's see. I wanted to tell you, Rick Tutrip, you remember Rick? He helped record, and Matt White helped record some songs too. So it's been the church family. Some of the old members that I remember so well, Alvin and Bunny Dick, Corky and Judy Birkdahl, Tom and Jackie Muzzy, and then Bill and Sue Spohr, who are up in Seattle now. They welcomed me like, or my whole family, like we were their own, and we'd have dinners there. We'd watch the 49ers game over there on Monday nights. They even invited me to a game. So the church family has been so important to us. And through all the struggles that we've had through those, the whys, it shows me that this is why we are supposed to be here. And the song that I'm going to sing is called Through It All. I've had many tears and sorrows. I've had questions for tomorrow. There have been times I didn't know right from wrong. But in every situation, God gave blessed consolation that my trials come to only make me strong. Through it all, through it all, I've learned to trust in Jesus. I've learned to trust in God. Through it all, through it all, I've learned to depend upon His Word. I've been to lots of places, and I've seen a lot of faces. There have been times I felt so all alone. But in my lonely hours, yes, those precious lonely hours, Jesus let me know that I was His own. Through it all, through it all, I've learned to trust in Jesus. I've learned to trust in God. Through it all, through it all, I've learned to depend upon His Word. I thank God for the mountains, and I thank Him for the valleys. I thank Him for the storms He brought me through. For if I never had a problem, I wouldn't know that He could solve them. I never know what faith in God can do. Through it all, trust in Jesus. I've learned to trust in God through it all. Through it all, I've learned to depend upon His word. Oh, I've learned to depend upon His word. Thank you. The one thing I want you to know, though, I've told you about all those people in the past, but we've got people here in this church right now that has touched our lives too, and we appreciate it so much.
Thank you very much, Tim. Anything Tim says sounds great. Well, Maddie Tuttle is going to come up and share with us some music as well. Before she does, a 65-year-old woman went to the doctor, and after about 3 minutes in the examination room, the doctor told her, "You're pregnant." She burst out of the room. She ran down the hallway screaming, pulling out her hair. A nurse stopped her and was able to calm her down, bring her into another room where she examined her, and angrily, the nurse went out of the room, went to the doctor, and said, "How could you say that a 65-year-old woman was pregnant? I examined her myself, and she definitely is not pregnant." The doctor replied, "Well, that's true, but does she still have the hiccups?" They get worse the more I tell. Maddie will save me in a second here. Maddie's been faithful to lead us in worship every Sunday morning along with her mom, and she's also been a staple of our harvest dinners in the past. It's also, Tim talking about church family, well, you know, Maddie and Florence and Grace and Manuel all serve as deacons and deaconesses and serve on worship team and in our church. And what a great family witness that is within our church family as well. So we're thankful for that, aren't we? Okay, Maddie.
I remember the first time Pastor Tom actually asked me to sing at the Harvest Dinner, and it was a while ago, if it doesn't feel like it, but it was, and he asked me to sing for, he's like, "Just bring as many songs as you can," and I was still new to singing, let alone performing, and I remember sitting back there, and I was so nervous, and it went okay, I think, if anybody remembers. But and then I, the past few years, and I've shared this before, but Pastor Rick asked me to sing at the Harvest Dinner a few years ago, and he told me, he's like, it doesn't have to be a performance. Like, you're coming up here to share, you know, your gift, what God has given you. Just remember that. This doesn't have to be like some fancy performance. And that's something that's always stayed with me. And so as the years have gone by and I've been asked to sing songs, I pray and ask God, like, what song should I share? What song, you know, that way it's coming from my heart. And some of them have been emotional the past few years, and it's just something so amazing that God continues to bless us with. Just this time to share together. And tonight, Brandon Lake came out with a new song called Hard Fought Hallelujah. And it's an awesome song. He was releasing it on social media, and everybody was like, "When are you dropping it?" And so it came out last week, And I was listening to it, and I prayed, and I was like, God, is this, should I sing this song? And I had a conversation at work, and they said, how are you so patient with the kids? And you're so gracious to them. And I've had parents thank me, you know, even just within this last week, like, thank you for being patient. Like, how do you, I don't know how you do it. And in my mind, all I'm thinking is, God is so patient with us. He is so gracious. And with this song, no matter what life gives us, and it's funny, Pastor Rick's sermon this morning, he said, people say, you know, how can God be so good if these bad things happen? Well, we are so fortunate. He's promised us, you know, eternity, everlasting life. And no matter how tired we are, our hallelujahs, he takes them all. He takes our praises. And so I hope you guys can get that from that song tonight.
That's when I need it the most. So I'ma keep on singing till my soul catches up with my song. There's times when my hands go up freely and times that it costs. There's days when a praise comes out easy, days when it takes all the strength I've got. So I'll bring my heart failed, been through hell, hallelujah. I'll bring my storm-tossed, torn sail, story to tell, hallelujah. Oh, 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 'cause God, you've been patient, God, you've been gracious, faithful whatever I'm feeling or facing. So I'll bring my heartfelt, it is well, hallelujah, hallelujah. Yeah, I've wrestled with the darkness, but I'm trying to reach for the light. Yeah, the struggle keeps me honest, and it breaks down the walls of my pride. 'Cause faith is improving like gold till it's been through the fire. Hey, my head hard and hands feeling heavy, but that's when I lift them just a little higher. So I'll bring my heartfelt, been through hell, hallelujah. And I'll bring my storm-tossed, torn sail, story to tell, hallelujah. Whoa, whoa, whoa. 'Cause God, you've been patient, God, you've been gracious, faithful whatever I'm feeling or facing. I'll bring my heartfelt, it is well, hallelujah. Whoa, 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 hallelujah, hallelujah. Whoa. Story to tell, hallelujah.
whoa, cause God, you've been patient, God, you've been gracious, faithful, whatever I'm feeling or facing. So I'll bring my heartfelt, it is well, hallelujah.
See if I can get out of here.
Thank you very much, Maddie. Thank you. It's fantastic. Now, our next person to share tonight is Mark Mariscal. He's going to share a testimony with us. Before he does, though, I have a bumper sticker that says on it, "Honk if you think I'm handsome." Sometimes when I'm feeling really low, I go up to a stoplight. When it turns green, I just sit there for hours and hours and hours. Just about a month ago, Mark had told me, he just shared with me here in the fellowship hall after a Sunday service. He said, "You know what, Pastor Rick, I'd really like to share my testimony again." Mark has shared his testimony a few times in our church, I believe. He's even shared it at a Mount Hermon's men's retreat before. And very happy to have Mark share with us. So, Mark, can't remember where you are. Where's he at? There he is. That's right. Okay, Mark, come on up and share with us. Thank you, Mark.
I have so much to be thankful for. I am so thankful for my church family. I love all of you. You walk with me, you talk with me. And Jesus put you in my life for a reason. So I want you all to know I love you. You know, as a child, I grew up in a loving home with good parents, a brother and a sister. We prayed before dinner and before bed, but we didn't attend church, and there was no personal relationship with God. When I was 10 years old, our family moved to a 20-acre farm. It had grapes and alfalfa. We had horses, which was my favorite animal. We had cattle, chickens, and many other animals, including a pet pig. I gotta tell you, that pig was a great pig. I loved that pig. But something happened, and that pig only had three legs. You know why that is, Pastor? Why that pig only had three legs?
Nope.
A pig that good, you can't eat it all at one time. I couldn't stop. I couldn't help myself on that. Life was good. Life was good. It was wonderful. And we continued to pray, but we didn't go to church. And while I take this moment to say the prayer is great, it's a must. And I love prayer. But God wants more than prayer. He wants your heart. He wants all of you. He wants to have you in a church family. He wants you to serve in programs, be part of programs. tell your story. So although prayer was good, it wasn't enough. As I got into high school, my first 2 years in high school were pretty good. You know, I played on the football team. I was a starting wide receiver, pretty good at it. Caught 1/3 of our total touchdowns 1 year. We scored 3 touchdowns that year. It was against Sanger. I was a starting second baseman on my baseball team. Things were good. In my junior year, my life took a big turn. I started hanging out with the wrong people, smoking cigarettes, smoking pot, drinking. I was getting into all kinds of shenanigans. I started just partying, chasing girls, driving my car, racing my car. I was becoming a drug addict. After high school, I met my future wife, Teresa. We dated for 6 years. We got married in 1986. In 1987, we had our first daughter. We named her Beth Leanne. She was born premature when Teresa was only 5 1/2 months pregnant. She was with us for 1 day. She was so small that she could fit in Barbie's clothes. The emotional pain that Teresa and I went through didn't open my eyes. I continued spiraling out of control. And over the next several years, we went on to have 3 more daughters and 1 son. During these years, I continued doing drugs and practicing a lifestyle that was not pleasing to God. And I followed a motto, if it feels good, do it. And that caused our family to struggle and strain, and it was really hard to make ends meet. I had become a full-blown meth addict. I worked to buy drugs, and then I did drugs so I can work. You can even say I snorted and smoked away our children's college fund. My life was unmanageable. My marriage was strained, and I started selling drugs to others so I could get mine for free. I was an addict and a pusher, and I was miserable. The Ten Commandments, with the exception of murder, I broke them all. I was on my way to hell. I was arrested once for domestic violence and another time for being under the influence of a controlled substance, which was meth. I spent what seemed to be an eternity in the county jail, but it was really about 3 weeks altogether. But I'll tell you what, I felt so ashamed. And I never, ever, ever want to go back to jail again. Ever. A neighbor invited us to church. We attended, and we attended on and off. It was a church event similar to this. People were friendly, loving, and welcoming. And it felt good. We attended church for several months. and things were getting better. The devil still had a hold of me. And I backslid. I backslid into my old ways. And the people, the pain, and the suffering were all so welcome, so welcoming to have me back. It was like hell on earth. My life was a hell on earth. In 2006 and part of 2007, we lived in Delray in the housing projects. It's all we can afford. Over there was a lot of gang activity, violence, drugs all over the place. So my wife told me that she was going to take the kids because they felt scared and insecure, and they were moving out to her mother's house. Now, I love my wife. I love my wife and my children with all my heart. But that didn't make me a good husband or father. And anybody, I just want to say that again, and I'll just say it in general. Loving your wife and your children does not make you a good father. It makes you loving, but it doesn't make you a good father. I led my wife into sin and doing things that she was totally against. But she followed my lead. And I'm telling you, especially those of you who are the leaders of your homes, your families, out of all the things that I've done, leading my wife down the wrong path, leading my wife down the wrong path hurts me the most. And it's a heavy burden that I carry every day. I felt so ashamed of myself. I didn't keep my wife, my family feeling safe. I was a drug addict. I was a bad provider. And my life was unmanageable. I was a lousy husband and a failure as a father. Instead of being a good and godly leader, I was a loser. I was ready for a change. I had hit rock bottom. I admitted to my wife that I needed to make some drastic changes. So I was going to stay with my parents for a while. My parents had developed a personal relationship with Jesus and were servants in their church, so their home was a good environment for me. I didn't want to be away from my family, but I was desperate to get over my drug addiction. I also didn't want to put any more turmoil or drag my family through any more hardship. I was looking at the big picture. I was willing to spend some time away from my family so that I could come back a new person and be the husband and father God intended me to be. I wanted to be the spiritual leader in my home. My goals were to establish a relationship with God, recover from my addiction, attend college, and rebuild my relationship with my family. I tried to overcome my addiction myself, but no matter what I tried, I just couldn't. But I knew who would if I would just surrender. So, One night, there in my parents' house, I got down on my knees, and with tears running down my face, tears of shame and regret, I said a prayer. I said a prayer from the deepest part of my heart. And in that prayer, I turned my life over to God. Here's that prayer, which became a life changer for me. God, I confess that I'm a sinner, but I don't want to sin anymore. I accept Jesus as my Savior and Lord. I ask for forgiveness for my sins, and that you would take my sins, cast them out, and remember them no more. I believe that you can restore my life, transform me into the man that you want me to be, and the father that you intend me to be. And the husband that you want me to be. Thank you for everything you are going to do for me. I give you all the honor and glory. In Jesus' name, amen. And as I was there on my knees, something came over me. And I was filled with the Holy Spirit. The chains of bondage were gone. And I continued to cry. But my tears, brothers and sisters, my tears were of joy at that moment. I have been bound in chains for so long. And I changed my tears. God changed my tears from sorrow and shame to joy. That earnest prayer and a step of faith were the beginning of my personal relationship with God. And I eventually fell asleep. And the next morning when I woke up, God lifted me up. He dusted me off, and he said, "My son, I'm not done with you yet." I was delivered from my addiction. Thank you, Jesus. Can I get an amen? I continued to pray, attend church, and turn my life over to God. I wanted to become a building inspector, so I found a building inspection program at Butte College in Oroville, California. So by faith, I applied for the program and a grant. And although I didn't want to be away from my wife and children, I loaded my clothes, my bike, and my Bible. I loaded them into my truck, and I went up north. It was a Sunday. And I stayed in a small hotel for the night. The next morning, Monday, I went to school. I found out that I was 8th on the waiting list to get into this program. It was a program that was in high demand. So my chances of getting into this program, being 8th on the list, were very, very slim. On Tuesday, I was accepted into the program. God was working in my life. And on Wednesday, I found a room to rent. Check this out. God provided me a room in Paradise, California. Yeah. That room was in the newspaper that I went through the night before at the motel. It was a motel. Scraped up everything that I had in my hands to pay for it. And It was a single lady, single mom, that was renting a room in Paradise, California. My references were not that good. We had got evicted just 2 years before that. So I said, I'm going to try for it. And you know what? I don't think she even checked my references. I think that God blessed me. I think God put it on her heart to rent me that room. Another blessing. And I also found a home church, which was just really important that I found a home church down there. I received grants and monies to pay for my school, living expenses, and I had some money, which wasn't much, but I sent it to my wife and children. Blessings and more blessings were falling on me. I felt so different. People looked at me and talked to me different, much differently than I was used to. I was learning how to live again. And after all those years of wasting my life, someone even said to me, "You have God in your life. I can see it in your smile. I am a new man. The old man in me is dead and he's gone. And I am redeemed." I felt I needed to serve others. So I volunteered at a local homeless shelter in Chico. And I looked for opportunities to share with others what God had done in my life. You see, at first it was all about me and how I needed Jesus Christ to help me. Then it became about how I could glorify Jesus. I was starting to grow in Christ. By having a personal relationship with God, talking to him every day, giving him control, letting God lead me, attending church regularly, reading his word and helping others, God was restoring and blessing my life. I completed 52 college units in 10 months. That's 2 times full time. And I made the dean's list. I thought God's plans for me were to get more education by going to school, to get a better job, to support my family. And although that was part of his plan, I soon realized that God's master plan was to draw me closer to himself. For me to put all my trust and all my faith in him so he could restore me and transform me into the man he intended me to be. And through it all, he would be glorified. By the grace of God, I now am a good husband. I am a good father. I handle our finances better. Our family has been restored. And I could look at my family in the eye with no secrets, but with compassion and love and Jesus in my heart. I am a new man, and I have a new purpose in life, to honor God. By God's grace, through my personal relationship with Jesus Christ, I am now the spiritual leader of my family and have served as a deacon and an Awana leader and Awana helper here in our church, where I also brought my son for Awana. Brothers and sisters, no matter what you've done in the past or where you've been, if you're tired of the old person in you, if you're ready to make a change, if you need forgiveness, and you, or you need to restore a relationship, then surrender. Surrender and turn your life over to God. Confess you are a sinner. Ask forgiveness and accept Jesus Christ as your Savior. It will be the best decision you will ever make. Glory be to God. Amen.
Thank you, Mark. You got to look. Go look over there. Yeah. Well, save the best for last. My wife is going to play a little song for us. Before she does, though, at a couples counseling session, the speaker mentioned that the couples are so disconnected, generally, that 85% of husbands don't even know their wife's favorite flower. So Mick turned to his wife and whispered, "It's self-rising, right?" One more. A husband asks his wife why she keeps buying all these plants when she ends up just killing all of them. None of them survive. The wife responded, she said, "I just want to keep reminding you what I'm capable of." Well, my wife is capable of many, many things. And she had a big hand in making tonight happen. And so, yeah. Now she's going to play for us. Thank you, dear.
Well, we heard this song 2 weeks ago, Rick and I, at a pastor's and wife's dinner, and it really ministered to me. And it's very new, so hopefully I can get through it. But I hope that it encourages you.
Trust in you alone.
for the Lord my shepherd leads me, leads me, and he is all I need. In the darkest valley I know my shepherd is all I need. I rest my soul in you alone. You light my way, you lead me on. I rest my soul in you alone. You light my way, you lead me on. I rest my soul in you alone. You light my way, you lead me on. For the Lord my shepherd leads me, leads me, and he is all I need. In the darkest valley I know my shepherd is all I need. I rest my soul in you alone. You light my way, you lead me on. I rest my soul in you alone. You light my way, you lead me on.
My wife.
Well, I'm about to dismiss us, and I would like to dismiss us with a benediction before I do. A few announcements, and I'm looking at my wife to make sure I get this all right. So, It's good. So, on the tables, the centerpiece is up for grabs, but to help recoup cost for the church tonight, if you could fight at your tables to the death, and whoever wins, if you could donate $10 for that centerpiece, that would be fantastic, and that'll help recoup costs to our church. In addition to that, we also have 12 bags of meat left over, so lots of turkey, yes? So just turkey, yeah, all the ham's gone. 12 bags of turkey. And also to help recoup costs to the church, we're asking just $10 a bag. You can meet at that window over there, yes? Yeah, that the doors that are closed, those double doors, you meet over there, and you can grab a bag or two or so of turkey, and that would also help our church out. The last thing, oh, no, she's got a finger. Oh, there's a centerpiece behind Lauren Paredes's head that also has a jar inside of it, and it's a bigger centerpiece, and that's 20, just 20 for that. So again, fight to the death, whoever gets to it first, whichever, and you can have that one as well and take the whole thing with you. It also has a jar inside of it, though. Last thing, if you could just help kind of clean up around your table, we'll grab, you know, trash cans and bring them around and just kind of throw everything away and clean up just your area. Thank you for coming tonight. I hope tonight was a blessing. If you're able, would you please stand? And I'd like to dismiss us with a benediction before we go. And since we're a church family, I figure this is a fitting time to do the Lord's Prayer together as a church family. So I'm going to lead us, and you can say it along with me. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Thank you.